In the western United States, the vast region lying between the Sierra Nevada and Rocky Mountains is commonly called the Great Basin area. This dry, semi-desert land supports sagebrush and other xerophytic or drought-resistant vegetation. Within the Great Basin live the Paiute Washo, and other tribes of western Nevada. By developing a hunting and gathering culture, these Indians adapted themselves to this barren region with its heavy winter snows and summer heat. Of the few lakes in the Great Basin, one of the largest is Pyramid Lake, northeast of Reno. This is a remnant of ancient Lake Lahontan, a great inland sea which once covered this land. Its gradually receding shoreline left belts of thinolite formations, like this great dome. These unique mineral deposits are evidence of the climatic changes for over thousands of years. Thinolite is found nowhere else in the world except Mono Lake in California. This riven specimen, formed around a central core, appears to have been split asunder. Amid these wastes are scattered groves of pine nut or pinon trees, one of the most essential food resources of the region. Wide-spaced, low-growing conifers, these evergreens occur at altitudes of 2,000 to 5,000 feet, reaching heights of 15 to 20 feet. A crude wooden harvesting hook is used by the Indian to gather the small cones of the pinon tree. Often making long journeys to the pinon groves, the Indians will establish a temporary camp. From this base, they will harvest for a mile or so around. This is David Christie, a Paiute. He uses his hook to pull the lower cones within reach. These harvesting methods in use today by David Christie have remained the same since pre-Columbian time. A nearby bush, called rabbit brush, provides a traditional signal for harvest time. In early fall, its lemon-yellow flowers are a sign that the pine nuts are ripe. Harvesting begins and may continue until snowfall. David Christie put it this way: "We go by these rabbit brush here. When they get that shade, we start coming out to the hills. That's the sign, yellow flowers." The conical shape of David's burden basket makes it fit well upon his back. Squirrels and other animals also collected pine nuts for the winter. Carefully observing them, the Indians often located and robbed the storage places of these provident animals. Cones growing just out of reach are shaken loose with the harvesting hook. The burden basket is a general purpose basket used by the Indians to carry many different things. It is easily filled and emptied through its great open mouth. Cones growing near the top of the tree are beaten down with the help of a long harvesting pole. Telling more about the harvest, David Christie said, "You notice a lot of times when you're picking pine nuts how some of the cones are all right and some of them are kind of watery-like, soft. The good ones are hard. You'll find that out." The pine nuts are nearly always extracted from the cones at the gathering place. Poured onto the ground, the cones are warmed by the sun's heat. This heat soon causes their bracts, or scales, to open, liberating the pine nuts, which drop out, or may easily be picked out by hand. If the cones are green, the opening process may be hastened by burying them in the ashes of a small fire. After the harvest, the supply of nuts is taken home for storage and processing throughout the year. Near brush enclosures, which served as their homes, the Indians would prepare the pine nuts day by day as they were needed. Mrs. Winnemucca is a Paiute and daughter-in-law of famous Chief Winnemucca, venerated leader of the Paiute division of the Paiute. Her method of preparing pine nuts has been in practice since pre-Columbian times. The ancient baskets she is using are identical to those made today, but these were found preserved in dry caves. She has taken a supply of nuts just as they came from the cones, placed part of them in this shallow winnowing basket, and added hot coals for a preliminary parching. By this tossing motion, these are kept moving, and the coals heat the nuts evenly. The constant movement keeps the basket from burning. This preliminary parching makes the shells brittle, so they may be cracked and easily removed. Unparched, pine nuts keep well in storage, but in time become dry and shriveled. Blanching them with steam or hot water will refresh the dry kernels. The Indians of Western Nevada use their hot springs and fumaroles for the purpose of freshening pine nuts. After the last small batch has been parched, the supply is ready to be cracked on the metate. This metate, or flat grinding stone, is first placed on a closely woven basket. It is the rolling motion of the mano, or muller, that cracks the brittle shells and loosens the thin inner skins. As one small batch is finished, it is pushed off the end of the stone onto the basket below. The nuts are rolled a handful at a time until the entire supply has been cracked. All the pine nuts are replaced on the flat basket, this time for the process of winnowing. As the cracked shells and thin skin separate from the white nut meats, the wind blows the chaff to one side, leaving the kernels in the basket. Some small pieces of shell fall through the openings of the winnowing basket. A few of the shells missed being cracked between the stone implements. These are sorted out and cracked by hand. Winnowing then continues. Hot coals are again used to give the kernels a second and final parching. The heat makes them very translucent, and some of the kernels become so hot they actually explode with a resounding pop. The white nut meats become blackened with a thin coating of charcoal. After the coals are taken from the basket, one handful of the parched kernels is finally ground on the metate. Together with a little water, this meal is added to the blackened kernels. The whole batch is vigorously stirred to clean the coating of charcoal off the nut meats. Grinding proceeds with a dozen or two dozen kernels at a time, just enough for a single layer between metate and mano. The soft kernels are reduced to a very fine meal. The oil from the nuts makes the meal gum together and stick to the stone. It is removed by pushing it off with the ends of the fingers onto the finely woven basket below. Pine nuts provided a substantial portion of the entire diet of these Indians, a diet almost equally divided between animal flesh and vegetal food. Though pine nuts might not be eaten every day, they were a principal food for these Indians, a major source of carbohydrates. The pine nut meal may be eaten dry, but most Indians prefer to drink it in the form of a thin gruel, simply made by adding the meal to water and stirring with a looped instrument. Always used cold, it is very palatable with a slightly sweet, nut-like flavor. The simple preparation of pine nuts differs entirely from the complex processing needed to make acorns, buckeyes, or soaproot edible. For the Indians of this dry, arid sagebrush region, pine nuts provided an easy, pleasing, and nutritious food. Mrs. Winnemucca completes her preparation of an ancient food of her ancestors, but one which her people still gather, prepare, and eat to this day.